Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. We thank God for his goodness and his mercy. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. We welcome you tonight to the Lord's house of prayer. Sincere book of the word. Friday night Bible study. Amen. We praise God for his goodness. Above all things, we thank him for his word, for it is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. By we are warned, and in keeping of it, there is a great reward. And 1 Peter, 2nd chapter, reminds us, wherefore laying aside all malice and all guile, and all hypocrisies and all envies, all evil speaking, as newborn babes, desire the sincere milk of the word, that we may grow thereby. So be ye have tasted that the Lord is gracious. So we just thank him for all of his goodness and his mercy towards us tonight. Amen. And we're going to get our opening scripture on tonight is going to be coming from Isaiah 62. We're going to read just a portion of it, just a reminder. And it says, for Zion's sake, I will not hold my peace, and for Jerusalem's sake, I will not rest until the righteousness thereof go forth as brightness, and the salvation thereof as a lamp that burneth. And the Gentiles shall see thy righteousness, and all the kings thy glory, and thou shalt be called by a new name, which the mouth of the Lord shall name. Thou shalt also be a crown of glory in the hand of the Lord, and a royal diadem in the hand of thy God. Thou shalt no more be turned forsaken, neither shall thy land any more be turned desolate. But thou shalt be called Hezbah, and thy land Beulah, for the Lord delighteth in thee, and thy land shall be married. Amen. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading, the hearers, and the doers of his word on tonight. Amen. And as it was you saw in our subject for tonight, we're going to be talking about, we've been talking about the nature of the Godhead, explaining it from a biblical standpoint, line upon line and precept upon precept. Tonight we're going to wrap it up with just a study in why we baptize in Jesus' name. Amen. And we're going to look at some scriptures, amen, to give us this understanding. Amen. So let's get right into the lesson on tonight. This is another more or less doctrinal topical study. The first scripture actually we want to go to is Matthew 28. Amen. Matthew 28. And we're going to begin reading at the 18th verse. Amen. So, verse 18, it said, and Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen. Amen. And so there in that verse 19, because as we said, there's this ongoing controversy, which I said before really shouldn't be, but because the enemy comes to divide and conquer, amen, and he's done a good job, we have these issues, amen. So I'd just like to explain, amen, the word of God for those who may not fully understand, amen, to help them understand. And even not only that, but give you scriptures so you'll be able to say why you do what you do. Amen. And so here, this is Jesus talking, amen, and he's getting ready to go back to heaven, and the work that he had begun, now he's going to leave it in the hands of the disciples. Amen. Now we know with John, when he came, the Bible said he came baptizing with the baptism of repentance, saying that they should believe on him who should come after him. So when they baptized under John's ministry, they just said, we baptize you unto repentance, basically, probably, or something to that nature. Because they had not yet been given the name. Amen. But God has given us the name. The Bible said, there is no other name under heaven whereby we must be saved other than the name of Jesus. So why did Jesus tell them to baptize in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost? Basically, the reason we're going to see as we go through this, the disciples understood what he was saying here. And I'm going to try to help us understand. First of all, Father, Son, Holy Ghost, those are not proper names. Those are titles. My name is Elvin Dwayne Turner. That's my proper name. But I'm a husband to my wife. That's a title. I'm a father to my children. I'm a pastor to this church. But what is my name? My name is Elvin Dwayne Turner. Okay. But I have these other titles, these other roles that I play. Okay. So here he says baptized in the name, not the names. The name. He's only given one name. And so as we go through the study, we're going to see. They understood what he was saying. Okay. Because even if you look at it from a logical standpoint, what is the name of the Son? Huh? Jesus, right? It's not Son. So when they say baptize in the name of the Father and the Son, no. It wasn't telling you to baptize. Jesus' name, the Son's name is Jesus. And we're going to show you exactly why. Father, Son, and Holy Ghost come under that name, okay? Now, because this is part of the argument, basically, is this is Jesus talking, as opposed, they pit Jesus against Peter, because we're finna look at Peter. Go with me to Acts 2:38. We're looking at these two, because these are the two scriptures. And let me say this, because we here, we don't condemn. If you baptize in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, you don't say, I don't say you're going to hell, because I understand you still baptize in Jesus' name, whether you understand it or not, because it's the only name given whereby we must be saved. But let's go to Acts 2, and let's start at verse 37. Now this is after Jesus has ascended and he has sent the Holy Ghost on their Pentecost and sealed the disciples. Okay. Just before we go here, let me look at one more scripture just before we go here that I think is very important. Look at Luke. I hope I can find it right here. Luke. The scripture I wanted to get off early so I could get my scripture, but you didn't, so we're going to have to walk through this. But this is a very important scripture, so I want to, because this is after Jesus has risen. Look up where it says, then opened he their understanding. I know it's in Luke.
Luke 24:20.
24:45. 45, that's exactly where I was. Okay, let's go to Luke 24. And verse 40, we're going to start at verse 44. This is important because we need to harmonize what Jesus said with what they did. Because up to this point, their understanding wasn't open. They didn't even understand that he had to die and that he was going to rise again. And all they didn't understand it. But after he rose, look what he did in verse 44. Look what he said. And he said unto them, these are the words which I spake unto you while I was yet with you, that all things must be fulfilled which were written in the law of Moses and in the prophets and in the Psalms concerning me. Watch this, verse 45. Then opened he their understanding that they might understand the scriptures. Okay? And he said unto them, thus it was written, and thus it behooved Christ to suffer and to raise from the dead the third day, and that repentance and remission of sins should be preached where?
In his name.
Okay? Among what?
All nations.
Because one of the other conflicts is, they say, well, the Jews, because they didn't believe in Jesus, they had to baptize in his name. But the Gentiles, because they believed in Jesus, they baptized in the name of Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. But what did the book just say?
All nations.
Okay. It's not one salvation for the Jews and one for the Gentiles. You both have to be brought into the body of Christ. That one name. So let me read that again. And that, verse 47, and that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name among all nations, beginning at what? Jerusalem. And ye are witnesses of these things. And behold, I send the promise of the Father upon you, but tarry in the city of Jerusalem until ye be endued with power from on high. Okay? And then he was taken up. But before he was taken up, I want us to get it. Opened their understanding and told them that repentance and remission of sin is to be preached in his name to all nations. Okay, now let's go to Acts 2 and verse 37. Because this is the day of Pentecost after they were filled with the Holy Ghost. And Peter, and I want to say this, because you can't pit Peter against Jesus. You can't say Peter, because this is an argument that I heard, didn't have the right to say something different from Jesus. But I want to point this out to you. Peter was not speaking in the flesh. He was speaking by the Holy Ghost. The Bible said they were full of the Holy Ghost. He was completely under the unction of the Spirit. But so was Jesus. So that argument will not hold water. It was the Holy Ghost speaking through Jesus, and it was the Holy Ghost speaking through Peter, and Jesus had opened up their understanding. So they understood what he was saying. Now, verse 37. Now, when they heard these things talking about the people from what? All nations were there. Jews and proselytes. So it wasn't just Jews. It was Jews and Jewish converts. There were also Gentiles there that had converted to Judaism. Okay? Now when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart and said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? What shall we do? What? To be saved. And listen to what Peter said. And Peter said unto them, repent and be what? Every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Because another problem is, some people say, well, water baptism doesn't remit sin. What did he just say? See, that's why you have to preach what the Bible says. You can't make it up as you go. You can't listen to some of all these theologians. Some of most of them ain't even saved. And that's the fact. I'm not trying to be funny. That's the fact. Okay, we can see, and it's because a lot of people don't even understand what happened after the Reformation. There was a counter-reformation. The devil's working overtime to confuse the issue. And where is a good place to start? In the cemeteries, I mean seminaries. That's a good place to start. Because you put your people in them seminaries to teach what you want them to teach in order to divide and conquer. And that's just how it's working. That's really how it's working. And that's why you really need the Holy Ghost to understand the Word of God. Because you can't understand it apart from the Holy Ghost. They could. That's why he had to open up what? They understand. Okay. Then let's read verse 38 again. Then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. Because what is that name?
What is the name?
Jesus. And they understood that. Otherwise, they would not have did it that way. See? And all through the Bible, wherever, and we're going to look at some of those instances. I hope I can remember all of them. But we're going to look at them. Wherever men were baptized, that's how they were baptized. There is the only place, the only one place in the whole entire Bible, in the whole entire New Testament, where it is said to baptize in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost, is when Jesus said it in Matthew 28. That is the only place. But every place in the Bible where actual baptisms took place, it was done in the name of Jesus. Because they understood. But that's the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. You have to get that revelation. Okay. Now, verse 39, for the promise is unto you and to your children and to all that are far off, even as many as the Lord your our God shall call. Now, let's look at, let me see. Leave this the 10th chapter. Go to Acts chapter 10. Okay, and this is the first instance, I believe, the second instance. It might be another one in between these two, but I'm going on memory today. Have time to get it all done. But I want us to see now, and this is important because this is when dealing with the conversion and of Cornelius was,
Acts 8:16.
Oh, okay. Well, let's end it there first. Acts 8:16. Thank you. Let's look at Acts 8:16. And let's begin at verse. This is when Philip, I believe, went and preached. And they were saved. Let's start at verse 12. But when they believed, Philip preaching the things concerning the kingdom of God in the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. Then Simon himself believed also, and when he was baptized, he continued with Philip and wondered, beholding the miracles and signs which were done. Now when the apostles which were at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they sent unto them Peter and John, who when they were come down, prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Ghost. Okay, look at verse 16. For as yet he was fallen upon none of them, only they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. These are Jews. So that's how they were baptized, in the name of the Lord Jesus. Now, let's go to Acts 10. And let's say, now those were Jews, but Cornelius is a Gentile. He's a centurion. He's a Roman commander. So, look at verse 44. We're going to start there. Why are we baptized in the name of Jesus?
No, because I had a question
that
was answered.
Okay, what was the question? Circumcision, and those were the Jews, which believed were astonished, as many as came with Peter, because that on the Gentiles also was poured out the gift of the Holy Ghost. For they heard them speak with tongues and magnify God. Then answered Peter, can any man forbid water that these should not be baptized, which have received the Holy Ghost as well as we? And he commanded them to be baptized in the what? Name of the Lord. What is that name?
Jesus.
Jesus. He commanded them. So every time so far that we see that an actual baptism took place, it was in Jesus' name. And I agree. There really shouldn't be this conflict.
No.
But this actually divided the church. That's why you have apostolic, and you have Church of God in Christ, you have Assemblies of God, and what they call, I'm not any denomination. I just believe the Bible. But I will be called of Jesus only. Why? Because I believe in baptizing in Jesus' name. But I believe in the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost. I just don't believe they're three separate and distinct persons. That's why I'm taking time to teach these lessons, you know, so that we can understand, because most of us was coming out of Church of God in Christ. And I'm not bashing nobody or no denomination or anything. All I'm showing is, because this was the issue when I was in the Church of God in Christ, this was a big issue. This is why it hindered me in certain things. But I see what the Lord was doing, so I'm good with it.
But I want us to understand why we do what we do. So look at what he says, verse 40. Okay, we finished with that. Then pray they him to tarry certain days. Okay, now the last scripture in Acts that we're going to look at, that's going to show this same trend, is Acts chapter 19. But what we just demonstrated, really, it destroyed the argument that Gentiles were to baptize in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, and Jews were to baptize in the name of Jesus, because Cornelius was Gentile. And we read earlier that they were repentance and remission of sin was to be preached in his name. And when they asked, what must we do to be baptized? To be saved? He said, repent and be baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. For what? Remission of sin. So remission of sin is to be preached in his name. And you know it's just something the enemy is doing to cause division, because everybody else, they do everything else in Jesus' name. But there's one issue. And I just pray God help us. And I can see him doing it in some people. But because I don't hold to the view that some diehard apostolics hold to, that if you baptize the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost, you're going to hell. I don't hold to that. That doesn't even make sense. Because the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost is Jesus. So if I do baptize you, if I say I baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost, what name did I just baptize you in?
Jesus.
You see how the enemy can mess us up?
Yes.
And have us divided and frightened? This one issue almost made me give up on being saved. Because I was like in between Church of God of Christ, apostolic, being torn apart. I had to say, God, you gonna have to open my understanding so I can understand this. And when he did, because that's the way I am, once he opened my understanding, I'm like a bulldog. I'm not gonna let it go. I can't. Okay. And so if you get me in trouble, oh well. Okay, but watch this. Okay, let's start at verse 1. And it came to pass, now this is Paul going in, to, I believe, Ephesus. And watch what happened. And it came to pass that while Apollos was at Corinth, Paul, having passed through the upper coast, came to Ephesus, finding certain disciples, said unto them, have ye received the Holy Ghost since ye believed? And they said unto him, we have not so much as heard whether there be any Holy Ghost. They hadn't yet got the news about the Holy Ghost, filling of the Holy Ghost. Okay, they hadn't yet heard, because, you know, they didn't have TVs and all of that. They didn't have all that. Word had to travel. It had to travel by word of mouth. So it had not yet gotten to them that Jesus had died, and that now we have passed from the Old Testament to the New Testament. John baptized and taught under the Old Testament, but now the New Testament, which is to be, everything is to be done in the name of Jesus. So look what they say. Verse 3, and he said unto them, unto what then were ye baptized? They said, unto John's baptism. And he did baptize what? Well, he gonna say it right here. Verse 4. Then said Paul, John verily baptized with the baptism of repentance, saying unto the people that they should believe on him which should come after him, that is, on Jesus Christ. When they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. And when Paul laid hands upon them, the Holy Ghost came on them, and they spake with tongues and prophesied. So every instance of actual baptism was done in the name of Jesus because the apostles understood what Jesus was saying in Matthew 28:19. So that's how they did it. And so that's how we are supposed to. But I say it again, I don't send nobody to hell because you don't baptize in the name of Jesus. Because you do baptize, even if you don't understand it, when you baptize in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, it ain't but one name. Now let me show us something. Go to Colossians right quick. Colossians. What is it?
2, and let's start at verse 6. We're going to focus on verse 9. Because remember, we are built upon the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. So we have to look at what the apostles said and what they did. And let me make this perfectly clear. None of the apostles did anything other than what Jesus did. None of them said anything other than what Jesus said. Look at verse 6. As ye have therefore received Jesus Christ the Lord, so walk ye in him, rooted and built up in him, and established in the faith as ye have been taught, abounding therein with thanksgiving. Now watch verse 8. Beware lest any man spoil you through what? Philosophy and vain deceit after the traditions of men, after the rudiments of the world, and not after Christ. You have to be careful, because we got a lot of vain traditions of men that are being taught, just like Jesus told the Pharisees. He said, you are teaching for doctrine the commandments of men. And so he says you have to beware lest any man spoil you or rob you of the truth through philosophy. And you know, because a lot of folks like to philosophize. Philosophy, let me pull that word up a minute. Jewish sophistry or clever reasoning. You know how some people, they like to get, appear to be deep. And so they end up getting so deep, they get out the word of God. They start teaching things that is not consistent with sound doctrine. Okay? And I'm not saying this to be mean, but the Trinity is not consistent with sound doctrine. Teaching that God is one God who is a Trinity of persons, it messes with the mind. I told y'all about what it really, how it messed with from Benny Hinn, man. He starts seeing nine of them. But another problem that you have when you teach that type of doctrine, I believe his name was Clarence Larkin, and he had just this chart, this illustrated chart of dispensations and stuff. But on the part where he shows heaven, what's supposed to be in heaven? He has three thrones. And that comes from thinking that God is one God, but three persons. God had a throne. I assume the Father was in the middle, the Son was on the right hand, and the Holy Ghost was on the left hand. But Jesus said that he overcame and sat down with his Father in his throne. So you have to get the revelation.
But he said, beware, that same man's fall, you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the traditions of men, after the rudiments of the world, not after Christ. Now look at verse 9. This is what I want to get to. For in him dwelleth what?
All
the fullness of the Godhead bodily or in the body. And what is the fullness of the Godhead? The Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost. Now, the reason I say the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost, because we know it was the Word that became the Son. But the Godhead consists of the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost. For there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost. But these three are what? One, and they all dwell where? In Christ. In that body, in that temple. Because like I said, if Jesus did not need, if God did not need to reconcile men unto himself, there would have never been a son. There wouldn't have been a need for a son. But he had to reconcile men, so that's why he said, what did he say? Sacrifice and offering thou wouldest not, but a body hath thou prepared me. But see, what they don't show you, because mostly when I was growing up, I heard him saying that the conversation went on in heaven. That's what everybody said. The Son said to the Father, I'll go down and redeem man. Prepare me a body. But that conversation didn't happen in heaven. Hebrews, you might have to help me, D. I think it's Hebrews 1, but it says, it might not be though. Where it says, when he bringeth the first begotten into the world, find that for me. So I'd like to have time to prepare before. When he bringeth the first begotten into the world, I want to show you this.
Hebrews 1 and 6.
Hebrews 1 and 6. So I was right. 1 and 6. Okay, let's look at it. Let's start at verse 4. Being made so much better than angels, talking about Christ, as he hath by inheritance obtained a more excellent name than they. For unto which of the angels said he at any time, sit thou, thou art my son? Watch this now. Because you remember, a lot of people, they try to teach that the Son was from eternity. This scripture is conflict with that. Watch what he said. Thou art my son, this what? So that means the Son was begotten on a day. That means he had to have a beginning. This day have I begotten thee. When did that happen? At Bethlehem. And again, I will be to him a father. So he's talking about the man, that flesh. That's what God fathered. Yeah. God did not father his word.
Right.
It was that man, that flesh. Okay, look at verse 6. And again, watch this. When he what? Bringeth in the first begotten into the world, he said. And that all the angels of God worship him. And of the angels, he said, is that what I mean? But actually, I was looking for that's one, but that's not the one I'm looking for. Because it says, when he bring the first begotten in the world, he said, sacrifice and offering thou wouldest not, but a body hath thou prepared me.
Hebrews 10 and 5.
Hebrews 10 and 5. I could quote it, but I want you to see. Okay, I said the wrong thing. Okay, that's what you are. Okay, let's look at Hebrews 10. And let's start at the first verse. Take some context. For the law, having a shadow of good things to come, and not the very image of the things, can never, with those sacrifices which they offer year by year, continually, make the comers thereunto perfect or complete. For then would they not have ceased to be offered, because that the worshippers once purged should have no more conscience of sin. We're going to talk about this a little bit Sunday. Look at verse 3. But in those sacrifices, there is a remembrance again made of sins every year. Verse 4. For it is not possible that the blood of bulls and of goats should take away sin. Here it is. Verse 5. Wherefore, when he cometh into the world, when Jesus Christ came into the world, when the Word was made flesh, came into the world, he said, sacrifice and offering thou wouldest not, but a body hast thou prepared me to be that perfect sacrifice. But when did that conversation take place? When he bringeth the first, when he came into the world. That didn't take place in heaven. So, and that's why it's so important. And I understand that a lot of people, they're just teaching what they've been taught. And if the Lord wouldn't have opened up my understanding for such a time as this, I'd have been teaching what I was taught. Actually, when I was in Korea, that's where I got saved. The young man, he was apostolic. So I was brought up to believe that apostolics was heresy. That was heresy. That was heresy. And so when he came, he was talking about baptizing in Jesus' name. I thought I was going to set him straight. I wasn't even saved. But I knew a little bit. I thought I knew what I'd been taught. So when we decided, we come together and look at the scripture. So when we came together, he said, you go first. I gave him one scripture. Matthew 28:19. That's all I knew. That's all I had. Then after that, he started running them down. And then I was like, okay, that's enough. Because I was coming under conviction. See, God know how to set you up. I was like, okay, that's enough. Okay, you won. Let's shut this down. But by the time we were done, I was under such conviction, I got saved that night. Yeah. And then I went to find him to tell him that I got saved. I didn't find nobody. And do you know before the night was over, the devil had talked me out of it? He told me, nobody know but me and you. You don't have to. You. The next thing I had took my, I'm going to tell you, see, I know how cunning our adversary is. I had took my cigarettes and put them in the trash. But before the night was over, he talked me into going in the trash and getting them cigarettes. That's why I always tell folks, when you get saved, make sure you tell somebody. Amen. But that's what happened. And because really, the scriptures bear out everything you say, let them say. We baptize in Jesus' name because in him, in Christ, dwelleth all the fullness. Because we're accused of not believing in the Father and in the Spirit, just Jesus. That's not even true. It's a straw man argument. Nobody would argue with me and get away with that. Because that's not true. We just believe that the fullness of God is in that body. That was the temple. That's where God dwelt with man on earth. But you remember, he's everywhere. So he was on earth But he was still on the throne, didn't he?
Huh?
Because he's in me, but he's still in you. No, he's still in you. He's still in you. He's still in all those that receive him. You can't limit him. You can't treat him like a man. You can't even treat him like an angel. Because the devil can't be everywhere. He has to be low. That's why I said, I believe his throne is over there in the Vatican. And he got a whole lot of demons doing his work. But he's localized. But he's the king of the demons. He's the lord of the flies. But he can't be everywhere, thank God. Because he's not what? God. Ain't but one. Ain't but one. He said, I'm God, and there's none like me, none beside me. I am the first God. When he said, I'm the first in the last, what was he saying? I'm the first God, and I'm the last God. I'm Genesis, and I'm Revelation. And everything in between. And everything after. Amen. And so, again, verse 9 in Colossians, for in him, in Christ, dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. That's where the Godhead was located. Remember, we saw that when we was in John 14. We saw how he was talking in circles. He said, the Father that's in me, he does the work. So he said, we saw it in Corinthians, where Paul said God was in Christ. And who was God?
The
Father. He was in Christ. But he was still on the throne. Okay? So, verse 10, and ye are complete in him. Everything you need is in him, because all the fullness of the Godhead dwells in him, which is the head of all principality and power, in whom also ye are circumcised with the circumcision made without hands, and putting off the body the sins of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ. Okay, we're going to stop there, but we just mainly wanted to show you why we baptize in Jesus Christ, because in him dwells all the fullness. When you baptize in the name of Jesus, you honor the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. The Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost. They are one. One body. Let's look at that just a minute. Ephesians chapter 4. Look at verse 4. But let's look at verse 3. But let's start at verse 1. How about that? He said, I therefore, prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that you are worthy of the vocation wherewith you are called. With all lowliness and meekness, with long suffering, forbearing one another in love, putting up with one another in love. Endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Because that's what the Holy Ghost does. It brings us together in unity. Okay, verse 4. There is what?
One body.
And the body is of Christ. The one body is of Christ. And one what? One spirit. The spirit is spirit of God. Or the spirit of Christ. The Holy Ghost. The spirit of your Father. These are the things that the Holy Ghost is called. It's never called God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Ghost. It's God the Father, the Son of God, the wisdom of God, the power of God, the Word of God, and the Spirit of God. Or the spirit of truth, or the spirit of your Father. He told them, he said, when they bring you before the magistrates, He said, don't premeditate what you're going to say, because it will be given to you in that same hour. For it is not ye that speak, but the Spirit of your Father that's speaking in you. So you have to see the unity, one body, one spirit. The bodies of Christ, and the Spirit is of God. Where you see, if you see any separation, is the fact that the Word became flesh. That's why when John saw, when he was called up into the third heaven, he saw the Father sitting on the throne. But then what did he say? I saw a lamb as it had been slain. Who was that? That was the Son, Jesus Christ, Jesus the Anointed One. We said that Jesus means Jehovah salvation. Jehovah is the proper name of God. Okay. But Jehovah salvation, because in Christ he became our salvation. Is this making sense? Okay. So I wanted just to go over these scriptures so we can understand, because we're getting ready to have baptism pretty soon, why we baptize in Jesus' name. Amen. This is why, because there is no other name given under heaven. The Bible said repentance and remission of sin is to be taught in his name. Amen. And I welcome anybody that have any questions, honest questions. We can sit down, we can talk, so we can get a what? Understanding. Because like I said, what I can't speak for no other fellowship. But what I want for the Lord's house of prayer for all people is unity. All of us speaking the same thing, abiding by the same, getting the same understanding. Why do you think he gave us his word and his spirit? If we humble ourselves, that word and that spirit, what? It'll bring us to a place of unity. Amen. So we thank God for his word on tonight. Amen. I believe we've shared enough, but if anybody have any questions, even online, you can always put your questions there, and we will get back to you. Amen. Because we want to help you today. God is getting ready to do something. I believe it. In these last days, the people that do know their God are going to be strong and do exploit. And God wants us to be united, because in unity there is strength. A threefold cord is not easily broken. So thank God for you on tonight. God bless you.